In September 2015, the United Nations adopted 17 Sustainable Development Goals as a universal call for action to end poverty, protect the planet, and ensure that all people enjoy peace and prosperity by 2030. Earth observation and geospatial data will play a vital role in measuring and monitoring these Sustainable Development Goals. For many years, the geospatial community has stressed on the role, need and value of geospatial information, but the uptake at policy level still somehow lags behind. Universal Policy Agenda is the need of the hour. Open geospatial data, global, regional and national geospatial frameworks, collaborative partnerships among government, NGOs, multilateral and private sectors, integrating statistical and geospatial information, new data to address data scarcity and data gaps. Today, political and administrative leaders have come together to share their vision. Their focus is directed towards achieving the Sustainable Development Goals and emphasize on how Earth observation and geospatial information can play a role in various national development programs and master plans.
So I have the pleasure to introduce Dr. Barbara Ryan, the Geo Secretariat Director, and she is the moderator of this session. With this, and she's also the advisory board member of Geospatial Media, and that's why she got this job to do. Thank you very much. Hand over.
Geez, what a great video and introduction that was for what I think it's going to be a wonderful panel, so thanks to each of the panelists for this. As the video implied, what you're really going to hear about over the next hour or so are the individual vision, motivation, commitment that each of these people have and their views on achieving those sustainable development goals that we just saw on the slide. And really just the importance of integrating Earth observations and geospatial data into this entire SDG process. So our first speaker is going to be Stefan Scheinfest, and you saw him this morning. He's been the director of the United Nations Statistical Division, Department of Economics, and Department of Economics and Social Affairs since July of 2014. He joined the Statistics Division in 1989. I think he talked about that this morning, having been a statistician for quite a while. Worked in various areas such as national and environmental accounting, statistical capacity building programs, indicator frameworks. He was responsible for the external relations of the division, both with member countries as well as with the international partner organizations. And so it's in this context that he really has been the substantive secretariat of the United Nations Statistical Commission since 2002. He's also been the secretary of the United Nations Committee on Experts on Global Geospatial Information Management. That's the UNGGIM effort. He mentioned that this morning in his introductory remarks. And so he's closely involved since the beginning in the establishment of that UNGGIM program and, of course, acted as the key liaison between the division and the United Nations. So we'll first turn it over to Stefan to get us started.
Thank you very much, Barbara. No right of privacy here after you've given all my vital statistics away. You're really not in luck. You have to listen to me twice today, earlier this morning and now again. But let me give you, over this presentation, a short overview of how we got to the geospatial dimension of the Sustainable Development Goals agenda. You have already seen this wonderful video introduction, so actually I can almost spare the first three slides here. This is the outline of my presentation. We will be zooming in, so to speak, from the agenda itself to the indicator process and then specifically to the geospatial dimension. Very simple and straightforward. The 2030 Global Development Agenda, I think by now everybody has heard about this quite a number of times. There will be a little test as you leave the room, whether you know all the 17 goals, and you can mention them in order. But you know what is perhaps interesting and important to know is the Sustainable Development Agenda builds on the Millennium Development Goals, which was the program from 2000 to 2015, and that had 8 goals, and we had 17 targets, and I think we had somewhere around 60 indicators. Now we have 17 goals, we have 169, I think there's a slide for that. Yes, these are the 17 goals that you will be tested on. And then we have 169 targets, and now currently we have 230 indicators. So you see, it's a quantum leap, and that has quite some implications and challenges for our information systems. So one thing that should be said is that the philosophy of the agenda is that it's an integrated agenda. The realization is that everything is related to everything. You cannot manage one segment of development and just focus on it in a silo mentality, and that has implications for our measurement systems, because we have to increasingly develop integrated measurement systems that bring together various strands of types of data and various sectoral data. Okay, so how are the indicators already anchored in the original resolution? So this is what was passed in the General Assembly in September 2015. This is signed by the heads of states of all the United Nations member countries, 193 of them. And there is already in the original resolution a reference to the global indicator framework that is to be developed by a so-called interagency and expert group on indicators under the Statistical Commission. So this is how we operate at the United Nations. We bring working groups together with a number of countries are sitting there, and in this interagency and expert group, for instance, we have 28 chief statisticians from information managers from 28 countries, and it's regionally stratified. We have so many Asians, so many Africans, so that we cover really the broad spectrum of types of countries. Those were tasked, this expert group was tasked, this IAEG, I warned you, the United Nations, we like our acronyms, was tasked with coming up with the indicators based on the 169 targets that are in the original resolution. And originally, we were hoping that we would be able to have about roughly one indicator per target, because there was no appetite of having too many indicators, because that's too many challenges afterwards for information management. But you will see later on that there are targets that are like almost several targets in one, and we will need several indicators to follow up on them. So right now the count stands at 230. And this mandate for the interagency and expert group was also to come up with an annual SDG report. We have published the first one in 2016 in July, and we are working towards the second one in July 2017. So every year, based on this global indicator framework, we will get a snapshot how the world is doing at a global aggregated level with respect to these various goals. I should mention one thing with respect to the next speaker. The interagency and expert group was very ably co-chaired by the Philippines and by Mexico, and it was really a difficult piece of work, I can say. I'm very, very grateful to my colleagues from the Philippines and from Mexico for steering this rather complex process. Okay? This is the situation that we have right now. So if you start from the top of this pyramid, we have these 17 goals, we have the 169 targets, and they are in green because they have been decided. We are now working on the indicators, so we are in the middle of the pyramid. We have a proposal of 230 indicators. This is being refined as we speak and then adopted by the Statistical Commission in March 2017, so in about 6 weeks. And then we have to move from the indicators to the implementation to get national processes and capacity building, and of course, in order to do the measuring and monitoring at the bottom of the pyramid, we need statistics, we need geospatial information, we need Earth observation and other big data. I'm currently running around in New York and everybody sees me in the street and says, "Oh, you are Mr. Indicator." And that's nice to be recognized as a statistician. That was not always the case. But my ambition now is to move on and become Mr. Capacity, because we have been dealing with indicators for the last year and a half. It's time now that we go even deeper in the pyramid and start talking about capacity building. As I've just said, we need the various information systems to bring them together for the breadth of these 230 indicators. You see here statistics, geospatial observations, and other data, big data, administrative records, and so on and so forth. The interagency and expert group very quickly recognized, and that is actually also in the original resolution, that there is a geospatial dimension to it. And, so there is a sub-working group, you see that on the top right-hand corner of this interagency and expert group on the SDGs, that is looking specifically at the geospatial information dimension. And this working group, here are the tasks of the working group, was tasked to look at all the indicator with a geographical lens, identify existing geospatial data gaps, methodologies. You can read this. There is another big contribution from the geospatial side is the visualization. And the last important point, provide granularity and disaggregation of the indicators. One of the elements, the philosophical elements of the agenda is leave nobody behind. And that's a policy concept. And to translate that into the information space, it means we need disaggregated data, not averages, but really data. And here is a little picture that I like very much. Statistics gets so far in our database to the country level, but with geospatial information, we will be able to drill much deeper. So this is also an image that I like very much. So on the right-hand side, you have the 17 goals. You will see them many times. On the left-hand side, you have all the dimensions of geospatial information, geodetic, elevation, etc., and so forth. And in the middle, you have all the traditional data elements and data disaggregations of the classical statistical disciplines and the three big sectors, social, economic, and environment. And now we have to find ways to integrate this in order to have better monitoring. And one of the first things this working group did, and I should mention, you see there on the top left-hand side, that it says GEO and UNGGIM, because this was a cooperation. The GEO experts were very active in this working group and helped us work out these various elements. So here you see in the rows the 17 targets, goals, and then on the in the columns you see the various dimensions of geospatial information, and then wherever there is a dark cell, you see that the group had identified for that particular policy concern a particular dimension of geospatial information could make or has to make a contribution. So I think this is sort of trying to drill in further. I have three examples, and that completes my talk, of how specifically geospatial information can enhance the indicators and make a contribution. Here you have an example of target 15.2, which is by 2020 promote the implementation of sustainable management of all types of forests, halt deforestation, restore degraded forests, and substantially increase afforestation and reforestation globally. I read this one target in completely so that you get a sense of what I said earlier, that it's not so easy with just one indicator to measure each target, because some targets are sort of packaged targets and you need several indicators to follow up on it. Well, here's an obvious way of doing it. There are Earth observation satellites that can track the changes in forest covering, and here, for instance, the red areas are where there was a significant change in forestation in Malaysia. This is Malaysia, Indonesia, between 2000 and 2012. A very obvious example. A second example, and I will not go into all the details again, just to get the idea, is monitoring crop conditions within countries at risk of food insecurity that is related to goal number two, that has zero hunger. And here is a geographic visualization of an evaluation of early warning crop monitors. So, and this is in South Africa, Southern Africa. And the last example relates to Target 11. It's by 2030 provide universal access to safe, inclusive, and accessible green and public spaces, particularly for women, children, older persons, and persons with disability. So this is an example of Sweden and Europe. You see, this is also true for all, for the whole world. We had examples now from Asia, Africa, and Europe. And this visualizes and makes it very apparent and measures the total available green space and the public, out of which then is identified the public green space. So these may seem trivial examples to you, but I think it is very, what they do at this point in time, they help to integrate statistical and geospatial information, which is not a trivial task. These are two separate professional communities. Sometimes there are issues with geocoding of statistical information. At which unit level do you do that exactly? So this is happening as we speak. So the integration of these powerful information systems. And the other thing that I wanted to highlight, it is specifically oriented towards a very well-formulated policy objective. So this gives you the flavor. I'm sure that some of my fellow panelists will even elaborate further and in much more detail some of those examples. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Stefan. And people in this audience may start calling you Mr. Indicator as well. So just not New York, but maybe Hyderabad. Our next speaker is Julio Centella, president of ANEHI from Mexico. And maybe you know, most people in the audience know, that ANEHI is one of those few organizations globally, maybe less than five, I'm not sure, where the national mapping functions and the statistical functions are embedded in the same organization. Julio holds a degree in economics from the Autonomous Technological Institute of Mexico, or ITAM, and a master's and a PhD in economics from the University of California, Los Angeles. He served as executive coordinator of the Mexican Petroleum Fund for Stabilization and Development. And in the Bank of Mexico, he's held several important positions since 2001, such as Director of Operations Support of the Central Bank and Information and Analysis Manager of Central Bank Operations. He really does have extensive experience in various financial areas, external foreign debt and macroeconomic policies. I think something that will be quite relevant to the subject at hand. So, Julio, welcome.
Geospatial Media and Communication for the invitation to be here in Hyderabad. And special greetings and congratulations to Survey of India on its 250th anniversary. I'm looking forward to our own 250 years of existence. We will certainly not be here, but at some point the institutions have to keep on working. My presentation is going to follow naturally after Stefan's one, because I'm also going to talk about how to use some of the geospatial tools to monitor the progress and the development on the SDG agenda. So I'll give a little bit of a background and then talk about how we see the match between geospatial information and the SDGs, and what further challenges and opportunities we identify. And I close up with a warm invitation and a commercial. A little bit of background. Let's look through the rear mirror and see what we see. Stefan mentioned these Millennium Development Goals. That was the development agenda at the global level for the period 2000 to 2015. And as Stefan said, these comprised eight goals. It left us with different lessons. One is that we have important data gaps across different countries, different topics, and different elements, and different dimensions. The second one is that we have a further understanding how different natural, social, and economic phenomena are behaving, and that would help us to understand better some of the causes and effects of certain policies, so that will enrich the planning and enrich also the spectrum of monitoring indicators that will be needed for the next agenda, next generation of goals. The third lesson that we want to distill from this MDG exercise is that some of groups of interest, certain populations were left actually behind. And that was completely unacceptable. And precisely that fact led to the motto of the SDG agenda, the 23rd agenda, which is leave no one behind. So that's an important element, and that's very important for the geospatial industry, for the geospatial information elements. Leave no one behind. And that can be only done if we know where everybody is. So that needs a location, and that's where you guys come from. This is another piece of information, so you can solve your quiz. Remember, 17 goals, part of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. And in order to follow all these things, we need a greater degree of timeliness and of disaggregation, as I was just saying. Now, within INEGI, we made a quick analysis. Stefan showed you a matrix of rows of the 17 goals and the columns, different geospatial dimensions. Here in INEGI, Mexico, we did a more basic analysis. And so here, out of the 17 goals, we put a little earth on those 11 goals that we clearly identify as having important geospatial or geographic dimension. So for instance, goal number one, no poverty. We certainly have to identify everybody in this planet, so that really requires a geographic dimension of where population centers are, both urban and the rural level. So therefore, we put the earth on that goal. And so on and so forth on the 11 goals. Now, this is a very basic exercise. In the end, as you can saw from one of Stefan's information or his matrix, actually, all 17 goals have a geographic or geospatial dimension at the most basic level. So there's a huge opportunity here for synergies between the geospatial and the statistical community. Statisticians have realized for quite some time the need of geospatial information. But now is the time that the geospatial community acknowledge themselves that statistical information is a complete and an important value to add to the GIS framework. Now, just some brief descriptions about the 2030 agenda is, it's a very ambitious and very comprehensive. It's a universal agenda, not only for the developing countries. It's a universal, as Stefan said, more than 193 countries or something, heads of state subscribe, so it's a very, very comprehensive. It's very ambitious, as he said. We have 17 goals, 230 indicators. Stefan already gave you a couple of examples of how the depth and the level of detail that each of these indicators has. So it's so ambitious and so comprehensive that official statistical information is not enough. We need your help. We need to collaborate with you, both at the geospatial information and other sources of information that are not at the beginning officially sources of measurement. So that brings up new challenges how to do this type of collaboration in order to achieve these goals. We have to produce statistics on new fields. Goals regarding the environment are completely new and are very difficult to articulate. there are no well-established methodologies, and these many of these indicators are not produced on a regular basis. So that's a big challenge for our communities. As I said, we have to produce highly disaggregated data, and we have to use spatial information tools. Let me just move into what we see in terms of how SDGs can interact with geospatial information. As you well know, geospatial information facilitates the targeting of indicators to support public policies. One of the most important lessons from the Millennium Goals is that policies have to be narrowly targeted to the particular areas or population groups that want to be addressed at central problem, because otherwise you basically can waste precious resources if you do not target your policies. So we did a preliminary analysis both on the geographical component and the environment component of different data groups and indicator at different levels, the ones that are shown on the right-hand side. I mean, whether it's hazardous waste or the atmosphere or water use, or the more basic one, the foundation regarding the geodetic framework or the some of the geographic names, for instance. And out of these 11 goals that I had mentioned before, we identified 65 indicators that basically meet the following criteria. The possibility that each indicator can be actually georeferenced or geotagged, as Minister said this morning, that we can determine the level of geographic disaggregation that is actually needed, that we can identify who produces this data, and that we can derive some kind of information from the processing of remote sensing imagery. And that's exactly what brings us to this panel today. How Earth observations can bring progress into the achievement of the SDG agenda. Now, these Earth observations become a fundamental tool to track progress. So we really need to integrate the statistical world with the geospatial information as an ideal way to monitor the SDG progress over time. And this, as I said, GIS or geographic information systems that you master well, much more than the statistical community does at the present time, allow for such integration in a natural manner. I like this morning idea of a systems of GIS, which one of those legs floating around maybe some statistical information element to promote synergies between the producers and the consumers of production of geographic and statistical information. Just one brief example that we're carrying on in Mexico. We're doing our own geographic information system, MX, or in Spanish, MXSIG, which is an open source web platform that allows for integrating a lot of geomatic solutions to facilitate the use and integration of precise geographic and statistical information. It produces a lot of geospatial indicators that allows to monitor some of this information across space and along the time. This is the open source platform that we're trying to disseminate within our own country and also within our own region. So it's part of our capacity building agenda within Latin America and the Caribbean to share this open source platform or GIS for the region of the Americas. One example, one application of this GIS Mexico is what we call the digital map of Mexico. It has more than 200 vector data layers of more than 70 million geographical objects and four raster layers. Here are some of the examples that we basically can incorporate in each of these 200 vector data layers. So we have a migration migration flows elements, terrain and landscape elements, road and land transportation, a lot of environmental statistics, and population and housing censuses have been already integrated there. The location and size and activity of economic establishments, as well as a lot of administrative and other geographic limits. In the end, this is an opportunity to advocate the environment statistics in an area of where we have a climate change. Jack Degmont was very pessimistic about all the arrows pointing down, so this is an opportunity of bringing our information and analysis to change directions and bring new methods and lines of work in order to reverse some of those trends. And in this particular case, Earth observations can contribute clearly in the environment arena to pursue the right type of policies that can be monitored and evaluated over time in order to achieve the goals that are pertaining. Now, in the statistical community, there is a big fuss about big data. That's something that the geospatial community masters very well. Walter Scott was talking about the dimensions of that geospatial information, so you're really aware of how to manage and deal with these big data. So now the statistical community is also aware of the potential, how this element can transform our policies and the information that we can share with policymakers to monitor and design actual and better policies for the pursuit of the 23 agenda. Let me finish up with my presentation with one important comment. I mean, as in this forum, the Geospatial World Forum, we have to establish strategic alliances between producers of geospatial information and producers of statistical information. Consumers or users of statistical information, policymakers need both of them, and they need to be integrated in intelligent solutions that can basically help to address a lot of particular problems and design the actual public policies in accordance. So we need to launch a comprehensive agenda, and we need to understand the relationships between the environment, the economy, and society. It's important that GIS, especially in developing countries, become an everyday tool, an everyday instrument, particularly in the statistical community. So we have a lot of opportunities to innovate and move beyond, enrich GIS with statistical data beyond the traditional boundaries, establish partnerships, and integrate the data. And before closing up, let me just make a very brief commercial and take this opportunity to invite you, all of you, to the 5th UN GGIM High Level Forum to be held in Mexico City from November the 28th to the 30th this year, 2017. This High Level Forum is the highest event on the geospatial information community, and it includes both UN member states and the private sector. In this contest, this will be the first high-level forum organized in coordination with the UNGGIM's public-private partnership. Mexico, through INEGI, is a co-chair of UNGGIM. We have the pleasure to have here Mr. Rolando Campo, co-chair of UNGGIM. And we're proud to organize this forum with the support of geospatial media and communications. In line with the priorities of the international community, the main theme of this year will be the role of geospatial technology in the context of the SDG agenda. We look forward to see all of you in Mexico City this November. Thank you very much.
Very good, Julio, thank you so much. Boy, I have to say, listening to these last two speakers, Stefan on the statistics side, Julio on the economic side, you two guys have surely made the jump over to the geospatial side. Let's hope those of us on the geospatial side can make the jump over to the statistics and the economic side. Let's see, our next speaker, third speaker, will be Nigel Clifford. CEO of the Ordnance Survey in the UK. Nigel joined OS in June 2015, bringing extensive experience of international software, mobile telecoms and services, including complex joint venture and public sector enterprises, has previously been chief executive of ProcServe Holdings Limited, Micro Focus International, Symbian Software Limited, Tertio Telecoms, and Glasgow Royal Infirmary University NHS Trust. In addition to those posts, he's held senior roles with Cable and Wireless and BT Group PIC. He's got a geography degree from Cambridge and is a fellow of the Royal Geographical Society. So, Nigel, welcome.
Thank you. Now, none of that means I'm qualified to talk to you about what I'm about to talk to you about, but I'll give it a go. So thank you very much for the opportunity to talk about some of the advances in auto change detection. And what I thought I'd do is run through three or four different topics. So firstly, a definition. What do we see as auto change detection and its uses in our part of the world? A little bit of an insight as to how Ordnance Survey is using auto change detection, and then segue into the Sustainable Development Goals. And pick on two or three examples, and Julio and Stefan, I will be using that same diagram. I was desperately hoping I was going to be the first speaker, so I'd have some novelty, but no such luck. And then I'll finish off with thinking about some of the stones that have still got to be turned, some of the challenges that are still out there, but also then look to the future and how change detection could be segueing into providing some new answers in the future. So that's the broad agenda. But let's start off, like all good essays, with a definition. So auto change detection, I won't dwell on this. It's looking at remote sensing, it's looking at a fixed area, and it's looking at it through fixed periods. And it's an area where we've been doing quite a degree of research, and it's an area which I think holds more and more promise for not only auto change detection, but then auto generalization and auto production or product at the end of it. So for us in Ordnance Survey, it means better targeting of expensive resource. So if we can sort 80% of change automatically, then that means a far less amount having to be validated manually. For the sustainable development goals, it means the availability of cost-effective information, and the previous speakers have identified the real depth and breadth of information that's required to report on that pyramid of measures that Stefan was showing us. So it means you can get that cost-effectively, it potentially means you can get that consistently across borders, and again, it also means that you can then reserve your funds for interventions only in the areas where it needs more intervention and more manual gathering of information. So I think it's an important topic for the monitoring and the future of the Sustainable Development Goals. So let me give you just a couple of minutes on how we're engaging in this inside Great Britain. So for the last probably 15 plus years, Ordnance Survey has been looking carefully at how we bring more and more auto change detection measures into our entire supply chain. And we've looked at many different methodologies. So we've looked at nearest neighbor, we've looked at decision trees. The way that we're approaching it at the moment is we take our detailed imagery data, we take our detailed height data, we then lay that against the algorithms which we've developed, and we sort it through looking at height, we look at texture, we look at context, we look at shape, we look at color, and through that we can get 10 classes of activities. Now, from that we can then compare it to the last snapshot we had of that area with those categories of activities. And that enables us then to drill down on only the items of change that we need to identify. So we then have change candidates. Some of those are just, they're obvious, change candidates. Others will need manually validating. So we then put that through our entire supply chain and, if necessary, into our field surveying force. But overall, this has been a really active part of our efficiency moves and also speeding up production of our information. So if I look then at the mandatory now, list of sustainable development goals, I think the very good news is I was very quickly looking at the black boxes which are around the 17 SDGs. because the black boxes are the equivalent of the globes which Julio had up in his slide. And the good news is we agree. That's terrific. We did not collaborate on this, but we actually agree. I think the one where there was a bit of ambiguity was around the partnerships for the Gulf. And we had the same discussion internally and felt that actually this isn't going to be achievable unless we do partner across multiple agencies. So I think we've got a fairly degree, a good degree of alignment across a couple of mapping and statistical agencies right there. I think the other piece which occurred to us as we were looking at this is the means and methods by which the SDGs can be monitored have changed enormously since they were first set. So these were set back in 2000, and in those relatively primitive days now, you look back on them, there were no smartphones. They were just a twinkle in people's eyes. Now they're being carried by billions of people and potentially play a part in how we might monitor these in the future. Unmanned autonomous aerial vehicles, again, a twinkle in people's eyes, not anything that was practically or economically deployable. CubeSats and the multiplicity of Earth observation options, again, not available at the time. So having set out these ambitious goals, we've now got many more tools in the armory to be able to monitor our progress towards delivery. And you can see, again, from the pyramid which Stefan put up, how desirable it is to get into more and more automatic ways of measuring this progress, because otherwise it could become a very, very bureaucratic and energy-intensive endeavor. So that's kind of by way of background. Just to give you two or three examples, which I don't pretend to be definitive or groundbreaking, just to indicate how Earth observation change detection is beginning or is actually being deployed and has been deployed in some areas for many years. So I think, again, Stefan put up the southern African portion of this, which is looking at how we begin to tackle zero hunger as one of the most pivotal of the Sustainable Development Goals. And it's been a key use case for Earth observation and remote sensing for many years, right the way back to Landsat 1 in the 1970s. And in this particular area, it looks probably in the same methodologies you saw earlier, looking at areas of concern in particular. So picking out in the boxes the crops which are particularly at risk or in danger of either climatic or other interventions which are going to be negative. Now the advances that have happened since the 1970s or since this SDG was set, again, have been manifold. So you've got far greater temporal and spatial detail than was available 15 to 20 years ago. The data is now becoming increasingly available free at the point of use, so it's not being locked up inside governments or inside countries. And I'll come back to that in one of the concluding remarks. And it's also being combined increasingly subtly and powerfully with advances in crop science. So understanding the impact of climate change of different subsoil characteristics on crops, so being able to plan at a far more minute level. So overall, yes, there's an understanding now of what, or greater understanding of what the patchwork of crop availability might look like. That's undoubtedly a good thing. But it's also had some other byproducts. So looking at the opportunities that might be there for additional crops to be put in place. And an interesting byproduct is how this begins to manage the dangers of speculation on the world stage. So perfect information begins to provide a more perfect market for crop distribution across the world. So I think an interesting example for the use of Earth observation. The other one, which is, as well as being applicable on a global scale, is really at the heart of anyone who is currently in, and 54% of the world's population is currently in a city, or who will be moving to a city. And again, that is a seemingly inexorable movement across the globe. So this is a picture of the last 30 or so years of Manila and how it has grown. Again, we've got advances, which means it's no longer just a picture of a city boundary with assumed housing within it, but it can now go down to individual buildings. It can now begin to disaggregate that into planned and approved development, or unplanned and unapproved and informal development. which becomes pretty important when you're thinking through sustainability, when you're thinking through security, when you're thinking about how you protect and serve your local population. And it's got resonances, as I said, for anyone who's sitting within an urban context. And within Great Britain, Ordnance Survey with our government, looking very hard at how we create resilient, secure, livable cities for the future. With some of the incidents over the course of the last few years, both climatic and otherwise, causing us to look very carefully at how we provide not just detail in terms of data sets, but in terms of live, on-the-ground observation of what actually is going on, so better decision-making can be made at a governmental level. So I think the sustainable cities piece is probably one of the most pressured of the sustainable development goals, and making sense of it inside national context and in terms of migration activity. And then the final one is looking at something which affects all of us, but perhaps more remotely. So looking at life on land, looking at the effects of or the changing pattern of biomass and support for the globe by the globe. So this is a picture of Gabon and the rainforest, the tropical rainforest in Gabon, using satellite observation to be able to build up a 3D biomass picture of that particular area. And again, be able to look at, obviously, movement through time of desertification, deforestation, but also being able to look with the increased temporal frequency at the effect of things like forest fires, as we saw up in Canada over the course of the last 12 months. So with this, you can begin to see how we can build up a really good feel for how each of these SDGs is progressing. You don't have to be on the ground. You can make very good estimates of how the SDGs are going from a long way away. But there are some challenges. This is fantastic data, but if it's raw, even if it's free, then there is a question of how that data can be turned into actionable intelligence. And there are going to be some in the room who've got fantastic resources, maybe centralized resources that are making use of it. There are going to be some who've got the raw data available, but then find it difficult to put it through atmospheric correction or auto-rectification to make it really valuable to them on the ground. So thinking through how we can provide the preparatory costs on top of the raw data is a challenge. We've also got the volume challenge. So how are we going to cope with more and more of these data sets being made available? How do we order them? How do we prioritize them? And simply, how do we manage and store the volumes that are available? Now, the good news in the third one is that we've seen a number of examples spoken about even over the last couple of days of organizations who are beginning to combine data with compute power. So GBDX was one that was referred to yesterday by Digital Globe. So there are opportunities or examples where this particular challenge is beginning to get tackled. We've then got how skills are going to get transferred, and that was something that I've been talking to a number of colleagues around the conference about, where we need to avoid an imbalance of data. We also need to avoid an imbalance of skills and other resources. Yep, and that includes the deep learning activities that we were talking about yesterday. And then finally, as ever, there'll be a potential for a knowing-doing gap, that we may see something, and we may observe something, and we may see that action is required, but then there may be a whole load of either resource, political, or other impediments to making a change. So while we've made huge progress and we've got more tools in the tool chest than we've ever had before, it doesn't necessarily mean that the path ahead is completely clear and smooth. But I think the path ahead we should be optimistic about. I think that we've now got even more tools coming to the tool chest. We're finding that costs are collapsing for some of these data providing or data sensors and also data processing opportunities. We're seeing the opportunity to borrow huge compute power on an ad hoc basis. We're also seeing the ability to measure things far more frequently. But I think the most important one for me is moving away as a mapping organization. Someone was once speaking to me and saying, well, the trouble with maps is, and the mappers, is you're always obsessed with the past, with what's happened. You've captured what's just happened. And if you're lucky, you're capturing it more and more frequently and closer to the point of action. What I'm interested in is what's going to happen based on the knowledge that you've got and based on the time series that you have. So I think for us, as the actors in the room and as those who are participating in Earth observation and the Sustainable Development Goals, the biggest prize is moving away from recording what has happened and thinking far harder about how we use that to predict what kind of trajectory we're on and what is about to happen. That could be of huge value to many, many communities. Thank you very much.
Nigel, thank you very much. Let's see, last but certainly not least is Jacqueline McGlade. Jackie is Chief Scientist and Director of the Science Division at the UNEP, United Nations Environment Program in Kenya. Prior to joining UNEP as Special Advisor to the Executive Director on Knowledge Management and Science, Professor McGlade was Executive Director of the European Environment Agency from 2003 to 2013, so quite a nice stint there. And before that, she was Professor in Environmental Informatics in the Department of Mathematics at University College London, Director of the Center of Coastal and Marine Sciences at the UK Natural Environment Research Council, Professor of Biological Sciences at the University of Warwick, Director of Theoretical Ecology at the Fitzhugh-Hulikin, Senior Scientist at the Bedford Institute of Oceanography in the Federal Government of Canada. So, Jackie, nice background there. Welcome, and we're looking forward to your remarks.
I was going to say, I've only got 1 minute left, is that right, after all that? Anyway, it's great to be here. I can still see quite a few people out there, so that's quite good. So I get the unenviable task of trying to sort of round up in a positive, enthusiastic way, which I will do if I possibly can, and try and ask some of the awkward questions about geospatial statistics, SDGs, and how on earth we're going to do it. So it's pretty obvious that from... Did I just do that? Oh, okay. It's pretty obvious from everything we've heard today that we've got amazing technology, we've got amazing analytics, there's all sorts of things that we can do. But I can tell you, when a policymaker or a minister comes to me and says, so what exactly is integrated policymaking? It isn't actually as easy as it turns out, because you need to blend data with insight, with the right question, and so on. So we've kind of moved from evidence-based policymaking to evidence-informed policymaking. And by that, we mean that we have to bring a lot more people into the room when policies are being developed. And that can be for sustainable development goals, but it can also be sectoral policies as well. So if we look at the sustainable development goals, we have to say at the top line, they are fully integrated and complex. They do focus on fundamental drivers of change. And somewhere embedded in there, we're thinking about managing trade-offs and synergies. All the little symbols underneath are just what it takes to deliver the environmental dimension. And the hallmark of the Sustainable Development Goals is that if you try to come in through the pillar of economy or environment or the societal benefits, you find yourself touching pretty much on all of the goals. It's unusual to find a place where you don't actually have something to say about one or other of the goals, and certainly the indicators. But how to actually look at where your preeminent point of intervention should be is perhaps the hardest challenge. Where it should be and how long it should happen for and what kind of interventions is really what certainly I am preoccupied with, together with the team in Nairobi. So when we look at data and indicators and information, it's not quite as simple as just going out and collecting some biophysical or some household survey data or whatever, because more and more we need indicators that are multi-purpose. They can answer more than one indicator process in the goals. They need to be scalable. They need to be transparent. We need to know where it's come from and easily communicated. More and more we have to talk about outcome orientation, not just is it going to meet the requirements of the goal? But what's the actual outcome that we're after? And so thinking about that in terms of activities and partnerships means you're going to make certain decisions about who you're going to do this with, and more, those are the decisions to have partners that can actually deliver on the ground. Doing normative work is important, but actually delivering change is going to become the success of the Sustainable Development Goals. So turning ideas into action means that sometimes some of the monitoring data we're collecting has to be actionable. It has to say, well, this policy is working here and this one isn't, and do we understand why not? And then, of course, we need to report on progress. So it's got to be high quality and it must be publicly available. So within environment, we have a lot of experience because, in a sense, with 465 on average reporting obligations from member states, we've had to go through enormous upheavals as to where something is changing, what is happening, but more importantly, adopting open standards and open access under the Aarhus Convention and many other ways. So to accommodate the kind of need of governments to not only bring together data on all aspects of the environment, but then to simply and ably show how to put geospatial, big data, statistics all together in a simple and easy way is really what we have been trying to tackle. And through Environment Live, some of you will know it as UNEP Live, we've had to change the name to Environment Live, we're really trying to show that whether you enter through stories, getting involved, citizen science, or doing more formal assessments, such as the Global Sustainable Development Report, or whether you have data from regions and countries, or whether it's for the goals themselves, each one of these has to be somehow related very, very properly to other parts. And for that reason alone, we have had to really look at our knowledge systems. We've had to look at unstructured data and really understand where and when it's appropriate to use it. And when I talk about unstructured data, I'm really not just talking about citizens and social media and sharing that, but going to stakeholders, talking to the private sector about data philanthropy, talking to citizens groups about data philanthropy. You know, quite honestly, we can equip the whole world with smart sensors, but unless someone wants to make those data available, avail the world of them, we won't move very far. So I was talking to a gentleman just before, just at lunch, about creating intelligent boundary posts, so posts that have got sensors on them. That's fantastic, but if the guy who owns the post isn't going to share his data with you, it's not very good. So the whole concept of open data, moving from the few countries that have open data policies to everybody sharing in that way, means that we will not only have more corporate wealth, we will also have much more community and global wealth. The global commons will open up again. But dealing with unstructured data at the same time as dealing with monitoring data, structured data, and by that I mean Earth observation and many other forms which have been collected in a precise and accurate way, is a massive challenge. And for that reason alone, we've had to really work a lot across the world with ontologies. And to give you some idea, we have about 4,000 ontology engineers working with us on something called the Sustainable Goals Interface Ontology. Now, why do we need an interface ontology? Well, if you're in the world of genomics, you know precisely that as soon as a gene sequence goes up, you will be able to, within a matter of hours, match it sequence for sequence with all other sequences around the world. There are pharmaceutical companies that hire ontologists and ontology engineers to do nothing but that. And what that has led to is a corporate understanding that if you want to make sense of big data, then you better understand the causality and you better understand the parsed language and the context in which data are collected so that your machines can talk to each other. Speaking to the banking sector, they really wished they'd had an ontology. And in fact, many have speculated that we would not have had the 2008 problems if there had been an ontology. And now there is one. It's called FIBO, the Finance and Information and Banking Ontology. So defense has got one underway. So we needed one for the SDGs. We needed one because even in the SDGs themselves, if you look very carefully, there are phrases like access to. Okay, so access to education, access to finances, access to etc., etc. But what does it mean? So if I go to a lawyer, if I go to the G77, as I did in the General Assembly, and I say, well, what do you mean by that? If you're talking to the legal structures, they'll be saying you need this institutional structure, you need this, 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 and this. If it's access to water, preeminently, you need to have water to be made available. So we've had to really bring out those terms which are crucial to the Sustainable Development Goals, contextualize them, and build full ontologies for them. So if you go into GitHub, I'm sure many of you are aware of GitHub, that's where you'll find an enormous community building the knowledge for things like resilience access, these really critical words that we'll come down to when we gather data together from geospatial sources, big data sources, indicator processes, that we'll actually understand how all these data will read and map into each other. In the formal world of policy making, in the environment world, for example, we have conventions, and those conventions require member states particularly to gather data. So one very early question was, well, if I gather all this data, can I use it for the SDGs? And so we did a synergy mapping, and it turns out, yes, you can. So on the right-hand side are the conventions and all the reporting requirements there, and on the left-hand side are the Sustainable Development Goals. Are they exact matches? No. Some of them are proxies. But with a very careful ontology, you can begin to see how gathering data for one particular task is actually going to allow you to do something for the Sustainable Development Goals. The big difference is the lack of geospatial data within the conventions. And so we see that there's a two-way mapping here, where by collecting data for the Sustainable Development Goals, we will also improve the way in which member states can deliver on their obligations to many of the world's conventions, including trade and economics, as well as in the environment. So this whole push, not only just for data, but how we use it, is one of the most innovative moments, I think. And there's a fantastic book, some of you may have read it, by Thomas Friedman, called Thank You for Being Late. And it talks about a moment when somebody is late for a meeting, which gives him a few moments just to reflect on different things, which he never has time when he's in a hurry. And in that book, he describes very much about this world that we're in, about the data and the innovation and so on. But what he really underlines is that the pace of acceleration is accelerating, which means that having intellectual property rights, filing patents, doesn't make any sense. You can file a patent, but probably by the time it becomes public in 5 or 10 years' time, it's completely out of date. So we have to change the way that we think about innovation. And as the custodian agency now for the indicator on technology and innovation, I can tell you we're having some extremely interesting questions with the patent offices, because in a way, they're almost out of step with what we're talking about here. Filing patents takes time, and by the time you filed it, well, you might as well not have bothered. So even doing something as basic as that is going to get quite tricky. So let me just delve for 2 seconds into an environment problem, air quality. I'm sure all of you have either been exposed to it, read about it, and know how many premature deaths we have. It comes from doing crazy things like, you know, burning on the side of the road, industry, and so on. The current map of air quality monitoring, public air quality monitoring, which is consistently reported, is something equivalent to the map up on the left-hand side. It's not very good, really, is it? So when we go to member states and we say, well, what's the problem? Cost is the problem. We cannot afford to buy the monitoring equipment. So some of them have got old equipment, some of them haven't connected it digitally. There's all kinds of reasons why, but the real core of this is cost. So we decided, okay, if we're going to have an influence on, you know, how the information is reported, not just for SDGs, but for just the general sense of having a cleaner, healthier environment, what can we do? Excuse me. So the first thing is, can you invent a monitoring system, a device, a sensor, which is affordable? So what's affordable? Well, I went out and asked lots of people, and they said $1,000, maybe $1,500. And this is for governments. But what they were asking for was a sense of, can you map a whole city affordably? So we invented a box and published the blueprints. It comes in at $1,500. Its equivalent is essentially $60,000 up to $250,000. So we've replaced a very expensive single instrument with a networked array of sensors. We've deployed it in a number of cities, and then, for example, in Nairobi, we deployed it across the whole of the city together with some, thank you, together with some highly polluted areas. That's great, thank you. And just to tell you, you can get really high quality data. It samples every 2 seconds if you want it to. It's GPRS connected, it's Internet of Things, it's sort of all that stuff. But the really clever thing is that within 2 weeks, using the sensor-enabled arrays and with some very smart analytics, we can actually do source apportionment, which means suddenly you don't have to do massive inverse modeling exercises, which means you do away with all that part of the equation. So we can point at places and say, okay, here's a great big lump of chemicals coming out. What's happening here? So almost overnight, you get policy effectiveness, you get real data, and you get people engaged. And you get governments engaged that can take action. Similarly, and I was delighted to hear the presentation from Digital Globe, they helped us produce this map. Within 1 week, we were able, on the basis of a request from Côte d'Ivoire, to map essentially where all the potential sites of gold mining were. And you can see there's lots of squares on this map, but it turns out that not all of them were gold mining. Some of them were scars from new settlements. So blending very high resolution imagery with a kind of fundamental question, what is the damage caused to Côte d'Ivoire and its forests from the gold and from the gold mining and the mercury that comes out and the arsenic, is a very important question because it comes to the core of their issue, which is their natural capital. So we need to be able to use these in investigative ways, as we saw earlier, but we also need to use it to transition into a much more, what I would call, intensive use of spatial data inside the system of national accounts. And this is an ideal way to do this, where you can do point source information and blend it and create the statistics of the system of national accounting. And this is where it counts, because the system of national accounts is where governments pay attention. And by including these satellite accounts for the environment and ecosystems capital accounting, we can put it onto the same level as whether it's a business, export, and so forth. In other words, the flows within an economy. Whistle-stop tour. The world is changing. So even within the SDGs, we have to realize that we create metadata that in of its own right will have time series that become, in a sense, out of date very quickly. Whether it's climate change, looking at sea level rises, whether it's looking transitioning from unhealthy to healthy environments, whether it's about water quality, every single intervention kind of disturbs the time series. It disturbs it spatially and it disturbs it temporally. So every one of these statistics is up to date up to the end of last year. But within a year, it's actually very different because now we've got massive droughts. Where I live, we've got cows dropping dead every day. It's really, really a problem. And our baseline against which we're going to measure things is changing. So to talk about a past of unsustainable production over which we're going to measure goal 12 for sustainable consumption and production means that we've got shifting baselines all the way through. That's a very different kind of mathematical proposition and a very different statistical proposition than one that we've had in the past. So we also have to think about how we're going to change our statistics to really look at shifting baselines and understand precisely what the nonlinear dynamics are and the transition states through which we're going. If we want resource efficiency, we're going to have to work on many sectoral layers, and that doesn't come easy because we've got locked-in infrastructure and we've got the costs of investment to get us out of that. So I'll leave you with this one thought. I recently got married to a Maasai chief, right? So once we've got over that little shock, I could tell you, living at the sharp end of sustainable development is a whole other experience. And I point to the man on the left. He's the guy I work with to do medicines, to gather and harvest medicines from the forest behind us. And these are some of the warriors with me. Two important facts. We know a lot about plants and we know a lot about medicines within the Maasai community. But what is fascinating is that in the last year, we have detected that many plants are adapting to drought by turning on a gene which creates prussic acid, which means that they are poisonous to livestock and to people. So at the very time that we're trying to adapt to climate change, well, the rest of the plant world and the animal world is doing the same thing. Similarly for medicinal plants, as plants are stressed, they put more effort into their woody structures, into their root structures, the very places where we extract medicines from. And so talking to the Maasai and talking to them about these changes, it is quite an extraordinary experience because without the aid of a map, without the aid of years of college training, of geology, of botany, and so on and so forth, they were able to essentially write for me what the world is going to look like in the next 5 years. They've already adapted, they're highly resilient, but they can already see that, and they smell the change in the landscape to the point where they understand which trees are going to be dying, where animals can go, where the wildlife from the nature reserves can survive. And I think that's what we have actually lost, is in the fantastic technology advances, what we must remember is that we have to listen very carefully to communities who are close to things. It can be in the private sector, it can be in the natural world, because without that intelligence, without that business or that living intelligence, we're not going to have the resilience that we want to achieve as an outcome. And the sustainable goals and the indicators will be measuring the wrong things. So I'm a huge advocate and enthusiast on, as you all know, on data and statistics and mapping and so on. But I just want to warn that the world is changing so fast that we can't really reach back into the past and hope it's going to help us go forward. So we need to not get locked in our data and our data, data governance and all these structures, at the same time as we're saying we mustn't lock in carbon, we mustn't lock in data. It is our new currency, and we have to be absolutely clear. We're going to get different exchange rates every day we turn up in the office with our new set of data. Thank you.
Jackie, thank you very much. Great remarks. Listen, we're running up against a real tight deadline. This is the room where the banquet will be tonight, so I'm afraid we don't have time for questions. I guess, but I'd encourage each of you to approach the speakers afterwards, maybe out in the hall or in the exhibition area. I guess the only thing that I might say is I really very much appreciate, I think in each presentation, first of all, I think you heard a sense of optimism, and while there certainly are challenges, and I think each speaker identified those challenges, with leaders like this in each of these institutions, I think we are in good hands. You know, and I think if you think about the discussion on this panel and the discussion on the previous panel, where there just was an outstanding suite of tools and products and services, it really is just about closing the gap, capability to use these resources not only for the wealthiest countries but for the poorest countries, and then also really doing whatever we can do to close the gap between how we speak geospatially and how the statistics and economic side of the equation speaks, because I think again each of you maybe referenced that we've got 100 years or so of experience with these economic indicators, and it's going to take a little while to bring the geospatial and environmental indicators to that same level. Please join me in giving the panel one more round of applause, and then we'll turn it over to Sanjay.
Thank you, Barbara. Thank you very much for moderating the session and helping us organize this very important panel. I would like to thank each one of you, Dr. Julio, Stefan, Jackie Magalhaes, and Nigel, who have traveled from different parts of the world to share their stories and their convening power to help us think in a direction which is of larger value. My apologies that I have to vacate this room, so I have to finish this session here. Thank you very much, sir.